While they're dismissing, will you please find in your Bibles Hebrews chapter 12? And while they are dismissing, let me speak to you of trivial and spiritual matters for a moment before we get into the Scripture. How many of you would be interested in running a 5K, church 5K? Charlie would, Joel would, Jordan would, Goo would, Nick would.
When?
Thanksgiving.
You can tell me about it when they're done.
Okay. Well, that sounds interesting, Michelle would. Okay, so yeah, it sounds like, yeah! Okay, I'm thinking about having a church 5K, just people in the church and anyone you'd like to invite. And I told Melissa, I said, I think I'd like to run a 5K. And she said, why? and I said, well, you know, I need to get in shape, and I think it'd be good to train for one, just so that, you know, I could run it. She said, do you know that they charge for 5Ks? And I said, well, why, we could have our own, and I could charge for it. And she's like, it's like $50 a lot of times to enter a 5K race. I said, this is brilliant. This is beautiful. I'll have a church 5K, and I'll charge everybody. She's like, but you got to get my T-shirt. I said, no problem. So I'm thinking about getting all my worn-out T-shirts and charging, $10 for a 5K. And anyway, I was like, man, this is brilliant. Whoever thought of this, charging people to torture themselves? You know, how do they get away with that?
It's like golf is, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't even have an argument for it. I mean, you don't catch anything, you don't get anything to eat, you know? I mean, I can understand fishing, right? Fishing makes a lot of sense to me. It's,
why don't we have
they
a
did
fishing,
it, people
why don't
do
we
it.
Have a fishing 5K?
Fishing 5K? Like, run? Well, Mike, you tell me how to do it and I'll consider it. You might be on to the next greatest thing, or it could just be a real flop, or flounder, you never know. Anyway. Hebrews chapter 12. You say, Pastor, I did not come here this morning to talk about that. Good, we're done talking about it, so you'll be fine. We're in chapter 12, and we're going to begin reading in verse 18. I'll try to read loudly, and you try to pay attention loudly while the kids are singing loudly in the back. Aren't you glad they know how to sing songs and hymns?
Amen.
And so they have to hear us, and we have to hear them, but it's a wonderful thing that we got so many children under the teaching and preaching of God's Word. They're having church back there. We don't have, like, you know, kids' entertainment hour. We actually have kids' church. And the format of our kids' church is kids' church. And the reason is, you know, most of our kids have never been to church. They would, to be able to sit in a service like you all are sitting through, they've never been trained how to do it. Now, I watch adults come in all the time, and they don't know how to use a hymn book. And they don't know how to look up books in the Bible. And many of you would say, well, that's me. You know, I'm just learning those things. Well, one of the reasons we have kids' church is so our kids know those things. I thank God for my parents who are first-generation Christians. And I grew up knowing so many things my parents had to learn at an age and a time in their life when it's a lot more difficult to learn. And so we praise the Lord for that. If you're ever distracted by the sound of it, just pray and ask God to give you the grace to help with it, and He will. And so anyway, here we are in chapter 12 and verse 18 of Hebrews. We're going to read to the end of the chapter, 11 verses in a text, and I'll ask that you pay close attention because there are things we won't be able to cover in the message for sake of time this morning. Verse 18, the Scripture says, "For ye are not come unto the mount that might be touched, and that burn with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them any more. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touch the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. But ye are come unto Mount Zion, unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to the God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also the heaven, also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. Now I want to read the last two verses of this warning, beginning in verse 25, but we'll read verse 27, actually last three verses, verse 27 through 29, and then we'll pray. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. Lord, please help us this morning, God, to be able to make application from the Scripture that will help us to endeavor to live our lives for Jesus Christ. We pray in His name. Amen. Let me begin the message this morning with the gospel, which is really what has caused the events that have taken place, which is the Hebrews becoming believers in Jesus and caused the circumstances in their life for which they're being persecuted and thinking on going back. The gospel, my friend, is the reality that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that Jesus Christ died for our sins. That's a simple summation of the gospel, that really is. But Jesus didn't die for our sins, but He was buried and He rose again. And the Bible says, according to the Scriptures, Peter's the one that penned according to the Scriptures, because he knew that the witnesses of the resurrection, the eyewitnesses, would one day pass away, but that the Word of God, the Scripture that tells us of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, would endure forever. So we have a forever book that is a testimony that Jesus died for sin, that He was buried, and that He rose again, and that whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you say, Pastor, that's a very oversimplification. I understand. If you don't know who God is, you don't know where man came from, you don't know where sin came from, I understand that there are some foundations that have to be laid. God made the world, and He made it without sin, but He made it so that man had a will to sin. But before the foundation of the world, God had a plan that if man sinned against Him, which he did when he took of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, God had a plan that Jesus Christ would be slain from the foundation of the world. In other words, Jesus Christ was already slain for sin. That's why Adam and Eve will be in heaven, even though they died, even though they were separated from God for their sin. That's why Cain and Abel and Abraham and Isaac, if you were to read chapter 11, all these individuals who are justified by their faith, they're justified by their faith in that which at their time was a future event, the event of the cross of Jesus Christ. My friend, sin is an important matter because it's against God. And sin cannot be forgiven the way that we think of. Sometimes we think of forgiveness because we're commanded to forgive, aren't we, in the Scripture? If Christ forgave us, we ought also, we should forgive others. We should love each other because Jesus loves us. We should forgive each other because God's forgiven us. But my friend, forgiveness happened as a result of payment. God is so holy, so righteous, and so just that sin has to be paid for. It cannot just be absolved or written away. Someone cannot do evil to you. You cannot do evil to someone and have God merely say, well, it's as though it never happened. No, sin had to be paid for. And the only way for sin to be paid for was either for the sinner to die or for a sacrifice for sin to be made. And the sacrifice had to be one who was not a sinner. The lambs that were sacrificed, all sacrifices were a picture of the innocent Lamb of God, Jesus Christ the righteous, who was, the Bible says, slain before the foundation of the world, but Jesus Christ, who laid His life down, died on the cross for our sins. Jesus didn't just die for sin, my friend. He was buried and He rose again. The Scripture says, though, about the death of Jesus Christ, that where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. In other words, God's ability to cover sin based on the payment of the death of Christ is greater than the ability of sinners to sin. In other words, as much sin as there is in the world, God's grace is greater than the sin. But something you and I both know in our conscience, and we know by reason, logic, as well as the Scripture, is that not every sinner has their sin covered. Isn't it so? There are individuals who will not go to heaven. There's a reason there's a hell. It's not only for the devil and Satan and his angels, but there's a lake of fire where death and hell are going to be cast into one day. And that place is a place where people who do not know Jesus as their Savior come. So if Jesus' grace was great enough to cover the sins of the world, what makes the difference between a person who goes to heaven and a person who faces God's eternal wrath? It's simply what you do with Jesus. The Bible calls it a free gift, eternal life. In other words, Jesus died for my sin, and His death was a payment. In other words, He died in my place. And the Bible says, "Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved." There was a time in my life as a child when I called on Jesus Christ, and I said, "God, I want You to save me because of what Jesus did when He died on the cross for my sins." I'd been taught quite a bit of Scripture at that place, at that point in time. But I'm going to tell you something a child can simply understand without even knowing all the Scripture, that they're a sinner and that Jesus died for their sin, and they received Him. Jesus said that we have to come to Him as a child comes. And if a child can understand, you can understand this morning. Salvation is not complicated. It's not intended to be complicated. Jesus died in your place. And you could pray a prayer from your heart. It doesn't matter what the words are, but it would be similar to the prayer I pray, which is, "God, I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve to pay for my sin. But I know Jesus died for my sin, and I'm asking You to give me eternal life because of what Jesus did when He died in my place." Friend, it's that simple. It really is. God saved me for the asking. And I haven't been a perfect person, but I have been saved ever since that. Thank God for that. Well, that's the foundation that's laid for what's happening in Hebrews, because Hebrews, as you notice from the title of the Scripture, is written to a particular ethnic group of people. Who are Hebrews? Who are they?
Jews.
They're Jewish people, right? They're Jews.
Yeah.
And in this instance, they would be the ones who at this time dwelt at Jerusalem. And as we have been studying through the warning passages in Hebrews, one of the things that we laid as a foundation was not only to whom the letter was addressed, but they're Jewish believers in Jesus Christ. They're not just Jews, but they're Jewish believers in Jesus. And here's what's happening. They're failing in their faith. In other words, they're not persevering. They're not persisting as they're going through persecution. They're being persecuted for two reasons. One is a political persecution. It's the fact that they're Jewish, and the fact that there's a Jewish insurrection against Rome, and Rome is going to quell or quash this rebellion. And literally, contemporaneously with when the Holy Spirit gave this letter and the time that it was written to the Jews at Jerusalem, literally, destruction of Jerusalem is imminent. The events are going to come when Jerusalem is going to be ransacked, the Jewish people displaced, not allowed to live in the land that God gave them any longer. And this is different than the captivity when many of the people were taken and put into the Babylonian Empire. At this time, Jerusalem is going to be devoid of Jews. And the temple is going to be destroyed. And so at this period of time, because of the persecution because of the events, it's not a good thing to be Jewish. It's interesting when you read through Acts, and I mentioned this last week, but it's important to consider. It's interesting when you read about Aquila and Priscilla being at Corinth, you realize that the Scripture says they were there because they weren't allowed to live at Rome because they were Jewish. And so there is literally law of the land that has to do with being Jewish. You think the Holocaust only happened in this past century, where people were branded and not allowed to live in a place, or deported or tortured for their ethnicity. My friend, it happened in the first century, 70 AD. It happened prior to that. And those are the events. So if you can imagine being Jewish, this is the closest we can relate to if you read up on the Holocaust. I had to read a lot on the Holocaust. If you read up on the Holocaust, the closest we can relate to events was when Adolf Hitler was having patches sewn on the arms of Jewish people. And when they were told, "You can't live here anymore, now you have to go live in this segregated area that is surrounded by walls and barbed wire in the ghetto." And so they're realizing this isn't the worst of things to come, but things are pretty bad. It's bad being Jewish at this time. And that literally those are the sort of events that were beginning to happen in Jerusalem in the first century. Different, but much the same. Okay. Secondarily, though, the event that we have to be reminded about was that on top of that, not only are you and your countrymen discriminated against for your ethnicity and because of events that are happening, but your countrymen would have nothing to do with you, including your own family, because of your faith in Jesus Christ. Do you imagine? You imagine these events happening, and then on top of that, your family says, your dad says, I have no son. Your mom says, I have no daughter. You're dead to me. You're following that Jesus. And so on top of the pressure politically, they had pressure from their families, because the families would have been, and again, the best illustration that would help you understand, remember when Jesus healed the blind man? And you remember when they asked his parents what happened to him? What did he say? What did they say?
He's
of age. Ask him. And why did they say that?
They would be kicked out of the temple.
Yeah, they feared the Jews. They would have been kicked out of the synagogue. They would have been disowned if they hadn't denounced their son. And so that same kind of pressure was happening to Jewish believers. What a terrible thing that is. I know I have personally very many Jewish friends who undergo the same separation from their family because of their faith in Jesus Christ. And my friend, unless you've been through it, you cannot relate to it. And so I would simply say, I cannot relate. I have the same relationship with my parents that I've always had, perhaps better. But these individuals, for their faith in Christ, lost their relationship with their parents on top of being hated. Okay, so Hebrews is a letter that is written urging believers not to respond the wrong way. Anytime life gives you circumstances, you have the opportunity to respond, do you not? Sometimes you feel like, I have no choice, it just happened to me. Well, there are things you have no choice about, but how you respond to the things you have no choice about really makes a difference. And so the Hebrew Christians, some of them were saying, well, listen, if my family, if I don't go back to the synagogue, my family is going to be kicked out of the synagogue for having a relationship with me. My family shouldn't have to go through this because of my decision to follow Jesus. Do you follow the logic, the line of thinking? In other words, this has a negative effect on my family that I'm following Jesus. It's too much. I can't force them to trust Jesus. So I'll just, you know, not necessarily denounce Christ, but I'll just go back to the synagogue. I'll just go back to the sacrificial system. I'll just go back to the temple. They had a temple at the time. I'll go back to sacrifices. I'll go back to offerings. You know, I mean, God established much of the temple anyway, so I'll just go back to the way I used to worship God before Jesus came and saved my soul. And Hebrews is a letter that urges believers not to go back. Throughout it, we have seen two themes. One theme we haven't preached, but we have been looking at the warning passages in Hebrews. One of the themes of Hebrews is that Jesus is superior to anything that you'll go back to. And this letter does not deal with Judaism. By the way, let me just say, I don't think I've said this very much in this six-week series. One of the things that's important for us to realize is that Judaism of today is not the Judaism that the Hebrews, the letter to the Hebrews, is addressing. In other words, there's no Aaronic priesthood today. Moses really isn't much of anything today. Truthfully, David's quite a bit because of Jewish nationalism and Zionism. But most of the covenant promises to Judaism of today are nothing. The temple, my friend, is non-existent today. Sacrifices are not happening today. The Levitical priesthood doesn't exist today. Do we understand? You see where I'm coming from? In other words, the Judaism of today would not even have been what these believers would have gone back into. They would have gone back into worshiping the way they were before the destruction of the temple. I'm sorry, before they received Christ, but not the way the worship was after the destruction of the temple, when they went to a synagogue system of worship that's devoid of sacrifices, devoid of atonement or forgiveness for sin. So the Holy Spirit argues with the Jewish believers and urges them not to go back from following Jesus, because Jesus is superior. He's superior to the angels. He's better than the angels. He's better than Moses. He's better than Melchizedek. He's better than Levitical priesthood. He's better than the sacrifices. And that was last week what we looked at. It was that Jesus, after he offered one sacrifice for sin, every priest, the Bible says, stands daily in the temple offering sacrifice. And the idea of standing is that the work of the priest is never done, Because as soon as the sacrifice is offered, the person can leave and sin again, and he needs another sacrifice. So even though God accepted the picture of the sacrifice, God did not accept it in a permanent way. But Jesus, when he offered himself for our sins, took his blood to the holy place where God is and presented his blood to God, and then Jesus sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And the idea of sitting is that his work was finished. It was once for all. So the last argument that we saw was that the sacrifice that you offer if you go back into Judaism is a sacrifice that has to be continually offered. And not only is it invalid today, but it's never done. You're never finished offering it. There's no permanent forgiveness if you go back to that system of worshiping God. Secondarily, not only that, but not only is it invalid, but friend, and not only is it never finished, but the work of the cross was a final work. In other words, you're trading a priest who offered himself, offered his a sacrifice that was forever, for one that can't take away sins, and one that isn't, that is only temporary. And so the believers are urged on the basis of who Christ is not to go back. But what we've been studying is the warning passages in Hebrews. We've been looking at the warning passages. You say, Pastor, it's a very long introduction. I know, I wish it weren't so. But if every person that were in church on Sunday morning were there every week, we wouldn't have a need for it. But it's important not to leave anyone hanging. The topics that we're looking at don't have a lot of meaning standing alone. In other words, if I just preach a message in Hebrews, but we don't understand who it's written to and why, it doesn't make much sense. It just sounds like a terrible warning to who we know, to who is it addressed. So there's five warnings in Hebrews. The first was don't drift. Don't drift. And the warning was, if God judged the angels, what's going to happen to you? You're lower than the angels. If the angels don't escape God's wrath, what'll happen to you? Well, the answer is, you'll escape through Jesus Christ. There's a comforting end in every warning. The second warning is in chapter 3, and it was don't harden your heart. Listen, don't harden your heart to Jesus, because life events are hard. Don't harden yourself. Third warning was in chapter 5, and that was don't fall away. Don't fall away. And the warning is that Christ cannot die again. He can't be put back on the cross again. So if you think you can go away from Jesus and come back to Him, you think that the cross is something that just happens over and again. And every time you do that, you're thinking of putting Christ to an open shame. Don't rebel, chapter 10, verses 26 through 31. That's what we looked at last week, and we saw that the destruction of Jerusalem was imminent. This week, our passage is don't refuse. Verse 25, and now we're into our text. Verse 25 of the Scripture says, "See that ye refuse not him that speaketh." And the argument in verse 25 is, "For if they escape not, who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall we not escape, shall not we escape, if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven." So the argument here is, don't refuse Jesus. And the example was the Holy Mount. Remember when Moses went up on the mount? And if you could read about this in Exodus chapter 19, if you have in your scripture and you're looking at the scripture, or you're looking at the verses that are mentioned previous to verse 25, it's Exodus 19 that is mentioned there if you want to cross-reference and study it. What happened in the Holy Mount in Exodus 19 was that we know that if an animal came near to the Holy Mount, he was to be stoned or thrust through with an arrow. The mountain literally turned black and smoked. And this is when Moses went up to meet with God and to get the Ten Commandments. If you read as well, one of the things that is an entirely different message, but something that's astonishing to me, is that the children of Israel actually had a discourse with Moses. And they said, "Moses, we're too afraid of God. Listen, if we touch the mountain, when God's presence is there, it'll kill us. And that's just too terrible. How are we supposed to have a relationship with God that if we come near Him, it kills us? No man has seen God, right? Why could not a man see God? Well, because in our sin, God's presence would just destroy us." And so their argument, the argument here is that God is so terrible, we don't want a relationship. They actually asked Moses, ask God, if you can be a priest for us. A priest is a person who goes between. and ask God if you could be a priest on behalf of us. And you and Aaron, you talk to God. You tell us what God says. Whatever God says, we'll do it. But we're too afraid of God to talk to Him ourselves. And that's a pretty astonishing passage of Scripture because of this. God had said, I will dwell with them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. When God led the children of Israel out of Egypt, His presence was with them as a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. It was an amazing thing to have God with you. I mean, God physically dwelt with the children of Israel. When they built the tabernacle, God went into the holy place. When they built the temple, God's presence was in the temple. Literally, the temple was at Jerusalem. If you read Jeremiah, one of the things that people thought was, we've got God in a box. They'd actually gone from being privileged to say, God's living in Jerusalem, God is at Jerusalem, and He lives with us, to thinking, God's in Jerusalem, and so nothing can happen in Jerusalem. We've got God contained. And friend, it wasn't that kind of a concept about God. God was not contained, but God lived with man physically. And that is the argument in Hebrews chapter 12. The argument is, God actually lived with the children of Israel, but here are the circumstances that surrounded that. Okay, everybody understand this now? You understand the illustration here? God's holy presence was so holy that people were terrified of Him they wanted to have a priest system instead of having to talk to God themselves. Now, personally, I'll just tell you this. I sure wouldn't want to go back, would you? I mean, at any moment I can go to God in prayer, and my priest is Jesus Christ. I can boldly go into the throne of grace, and God's presence is not terrible. He is my Abba, my Father. He's my Daddy. And I don't mean to be irreverent or disrespectful in saying that. I understand. I'm not one of these people that talks about God in an irreverent way. You listen to some songs that are written nowadays, and sometimes they make me quiver a little bit. There's that song, I Can Only Imagine. I'm not promoting or destroying the song, but just imagine, when they say, shall I dance with Jesus? And I just think, how could you say something like that, you know? I'll be falling before Jesus. I'm not going to be waltzing with Him. You know, in other words, there's a holiness. You understand what I'm talking about? It's just, to me, there's a lack of an understanding of who God is, even though Christ has been offered for us. When I talk about boldness to go on the throne of grace, I'm not going to go on the throne of grace and graffiti it. I'm not going to tag my name there, mark it up somehow. I'm going to go there grateful that I'm in a place that I had no right, that I have a relationship with a God who is my loving Father. But I'm not going to disrespect God. Right? You know, if you respect your dad, you'll never call him Pop. You know, you never call him the old man. You know what I'm talking about, right? You know, I never, my dad would have killed me if I tried something like that. I wouldn't even imagine disrespect, but I saw people disrespect their dad. How could you disrespect your dad like that? Well, my friend, God is our Heavenly Father, and we can love Him and have a very loving relationship with Him without being irreverent toward Him. That's for free. That isn't part of the passage of Scripture. But the idea here is that if you go back into Judaism, you're going to go back to a time when you are terrified of God. You'll go from a time when you have bold access to find grace and mercy to a time when you are so afraid of God, you said, you talk to Him for me. He's too terrible for me. Okay? And so we see a contrast here. We see a contrast in verse 21. The Bible says, so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. So Moses had to talk to God, but he was afraid too. In verse 22, but ye are coming to Mount Sion, unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. And there's a lot here we could discuss about the church and about what is in heaven at this time. You realize that until Jesus Christ was resurrected, that people didn't go to heaven when they died. You know that, right? When people died and they slept, they went into paradise. They went into a place that's called Abraham's bosom or paradise. And there they were. And between paradise and hell, there was a great gulf fixed. And a person couldn't pass from paradise into hell. But it wasn't heaven because they were not in God's presence, because the final work of the cross was not completed. That's why the saints, when you read about the resurrection, the saints went and they came out of the graves and they went into Jerusalem. You ever wonder, who were the saints? What were they doing? Well, they didn't come back from heaven. They came from paradise. And when Jesus Christ ascended into heaven, He took the saints with Him. And now they're with God. And that's why in 1 Corinthians we see that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That's why we know now that when you die, when you sleep in Jesus, you go to where Jesus was. But if you were to go back to pre-cross events, you wouldn't be able to die in heaven. You'd die and go to paradise, die and go to Abraham's bosom, but it was a waiting place until the work of the cross was completed. So you go from a time when it's finished to a time when it is unfinished. Okay? Now, verse 25 then. Okay, I'm sorry, verse 24. To Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. Oh, I just remembered something by getting the wrong verse there. I didn't announce the wrong text this morning. My apologies to everyone. I broke my streak. I had a running streak of announcing the wrong chapter in my text for a number of different services, and I ruined it this morning because I actually told you the right place in the scripture to go, didn't I? My mistake. I'll try to do better. Verse 24. And to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling, that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Now, think of the events about Abel, would you, for a moment? Now, Abel is a guy that invokes, for me, wholesome thoughts. When I think of Abel, I think of a wholesome guy, don't you? I mean, there's Cain, who God had made known to Cain to Abel what kind of sacrifice he wanted. Abel said, okay, and he offered an animal sacrifice. There's Cain, who was a tiller of the land. Abel raised the animals, and so Cain had, you could say, readily available a sacrifice. Did I say Cain? Abel had readily available a sacrifice, but Cain grew vegetables, if you will. So Cain offered what he grew to God, and God didn't accept it. God said, that isn't what I offered. It's a blood sacrifice, because it's blood that has to be shed. It's blood that has to be shed in order for sin to be covered. Sacrifice didn't work, and Cain was wrath, and he killed Abel. Abel's a wholesome guy. Well, the idea here is, as good as things were for Abel and his sacrifice, Jesus is better than Abel. Verse 25 now. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. The simple logical argument is, you can worship God however you well please, but my friend, God won't accept it. You see the illustration here? In other words, Abel worshiped God the way that God said, and God accepted it. Cain refused to offer a sacrifice to God God's way, and God said, no, I don't accept it. And the idea here is that Jesus Christ is in heaven. Don't refuse to do things God's way. Literally, here are individuals who have been described as having received the Holy Spirit, of having God do supernatural things in their life. They're believers. They've received Christ as their Savior. They've had the benefits of having Jesus as their Savior. And now they're saying, well, God, it's not working this way that you have of worshiping Jesus and not being part of the synagogue system. It's not worshiping, not being part of Judaism. It's not working for us. So God, here's what we're going to do. You say, Pastor, that's ridiculous. It's as ridiculous as it is today. It is fascinating to me that today the church is constantly being redefined. It's amazing when I ask people where they go to church. I'm talking about people that are believers. It's amazing what they tell me that they do for church. You know what I'm talking about? I have a Bible study. Some friends of mine, we meet and we feed the poor. Well, I don't mean to be silly, irreverent, or to disrespect anyone, but that isn't what the Bible describes the church as being. It's the assembly of believers, and they're assembled to worship God. Feeding the poor isn't worshiping Jesus. Or some people say, well, I do this for church. Well, how many Christians you know that say, the church is full of, I mean, they'd say it differently. Church is full of hypocrites and a bunch of phonies, and it's all about money, and it's all about, and by the way, I know what they're talking about. I've been those places. The church is this and this and this and this, and they reject it altogether and do something on their own. Well, pardon me, my friend, but doing something else isn't the church. Do you get it? It's amazing. People, you know, and I can relate to these guys, you know, fishermen. You know, well, you know, when I'm out there on the water and it's just me and God, I mean, there's just nothing like the worship. there, you know. Well, you can worship God out on the water, my friend, but it's not church. It's not the assembly. And the scripture here is indicating you can't, you know, you can't just go back into Judaism and say, well, God, here's what I'm going to do. God said, here's how you worship me. And here's what people say. Well, here's what I'm going to do. The messianic system today. How many of you know what messianic Christianity is? Anybody familiar with it? Takes the synagogue system of worship and plugs Jesus into it. And then does everything the way that, you know, the old, that the Jews do. In the pagan Judaism, which is not even prescribed in the scripture. It's amazing. And they say, well, you know what, this is, you know, we're Jewish, this is what we do. Well, God is here in Hebrews 12 saying, I'm God. You don't tell me what you're going to do. Do you see the warning here? Warning is, I'm God. Don't tell me what you're going to do. Now, friend, we've grown up, we've had so many generations of don't let anybody tell you anything that it's really hard for us to relate to God as a God who is superior, who is an absolute authority. We have so much problem with authority that knowing God as an authority just rankles most of us. It really does. Most of us cannot stand. You want to get somebody mad, tell them what to do. And tell them, I don't care what you think, do it. You want to get somebody mad, just try it. It makes me mad, I'll tell you. Somebody's telling me what to do. You know what I'm talking about? We don't like to be told what to do. And we live in a generation where it's considered to be disrespectful to tell someone what to do, even if you have the right to. But friend, all of that messes up our thinking. All of that's satanic because God is God. And He made us. We're His. We belong to Him. And the idea of servant or slave is so appalling to us that anybody could own us. But my friend, you either would have gone to hell because you belong to God and you were His to judge with His almighty wrath, or you're a servant of God because He bought you with the blood of His Son. But we're servants, and it's right for servants to obey the Master. And here are individuals that are saying, well, God, pardon me, but I don't like what you said to do because it's causing trouble, so I've come up with my own thing, and I'm going to worship you this way. And the idea is, do you remember the God of the temple? Do you remember Mount Sinai? Do you remember the fire and the blackness and the smoke and that an oxen couldn't even touch it without dying? And that if a person came near to it, they would die from God's presence. Do you remember what it was like to worship God? When you couldn't go to the holy place, but one had to go for you and offer a sacrifice for you. Do you remember what it was like to worship God that way? Well, not only is that an invalid system of worship because Jesus Christ is a once-for-all sacrifice, but my friend, it is not a more comforting way to worship. Listen, if you and I were worshiping in the temple today, I trust you, we wouldn't come into the presence of God and say, Dear God, we're asking for Your Spirit in our service. We'd say, God, please stay out of our service. I'm not being irreverent, I'm being serious. You hear me this morning? We say, God, please don't bring Your presence in us. We don't want to die. And that's what they wanted to go back to. My friend, all of us have a very short-term memory, don't we, sometimes? Sometimes we really forget where we came from. I met many a Christian that said, I wish I could go back. And I think, I saw you when you were there. I saw the tears. I saw the agony. I saw the grief. Yeah, things were better before. No, no, no. Things were not better before you met Jesus. Moving forward, we'll be finished here momentarily. The question in verse 25, if they escaped not who refused Him that spake on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from Him that speaketh from heaven? If you think that somehow you can escape God by not acknowledging Him, my friend, you're mistaken. He's in heaven. And heaven is a pretty high vantage point. You hear me this morning? Heaven's a pretty high vantage point. You ever been where somebody could see you and you couldn't see them? That's a little bit disconcerting, isn't it? And the idea, well, I'm just going to slip into the synagogue and God won't know. God knows. I'm just going to do this and it doesn't mean anything. You remember, I've always had trouble reconciling this. Do you remember when Naaman the leper was healed and he was forced by his master to go into the temple to the God? And he said, when I kneel, understand I'm kneeling to God. I'm not kneeling to that God. Well, Elijah said, okay. Okay, God understands, knows what's in your heart. This is not that kind of a scenario, my friend. God said, I want you to worship me this way. And they're saying, I'm going to worship you this way, God. Just don't look. Moving forward. The Bible says in verse 26, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. If you think that a God who could shake the earth with his voice can somehow be escaped when he's in the heavens, you're mistaken. Verse 27, this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. And God said, the things that can be destroyed, the things that can be shaken will be. What you have is unshakable. He's referring to their position in Jesus Christ. He's referring to the eternal salvation. He's referring to the eternal matters. I want to remind you, friend, we mentioned in Sunday school this morning that our life is temporary. It's temporal. There probably won't be a single individual under the sound of my voice this morning alive in 100 years. And I'm talking about physically alive, not spiritually. But if you know the Lord Jesus, my friend, you'll have just as much eternal life then as you do now. If you know Jesus as your Savior, you're eternal and you're forever. And the idea of going back into something that could be destroyed, the religion of the Jews was actually destroyed. Do you realize that? The temple was actually destroyed, and it's somewhat fascinating to me that men did it. But we, my friend, are worshiping a God who's in heaven, no man's hand can reach, but whose hand can reach any man. And the idea here in verse 28, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace. So you're thinking about going back into Judaism. You want to be insurgents. You want to fight the Roman Empire and reset up Israel. Well, all that'll take for that to be destroyed is for someone to come in and destroy it again. Who was it that sent the children of Israel into captivity? God did, right? I mean, God used Nebuchadnezzar, but God allowed it. There, when the children of Israel walked into the land of promise, the land of Canaan, and marched around Jericho, do you realize that the wall of Jericho was so wide that two chariots could go around it at once? It was so tall, what was it, 60 foot tall, 60 foot high? You think a man could scale that wall and defeat the mighty people that were there? No, but they walked around and the walls fell down. They were not men of war. They were fighting people who were men of war, but God gave them the victory. And when the children of Israel were taken out of Israel, when they were taken into the captivity, my friend, they were taken by God. The Bible says in verse 28, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fire. So here are people who are wanting to go back into a kingdom that could be destroyed when they're serving a God whose kingdom is forever. There's going to be a time when Jesus Christ rules and reigns on this earth. And what's going to happen after his 1,000-year reign on this earth? It's going to be destroyed. Even the kingdom that Christ reigns on this earth will be a kingdom that reigns on an earth that can be destroyed. But my friend, Christ's kingdom, the one that we're part of, when that kingdom is destroyed, guess where we'll be? We'll be with him. We'll be in heaven, and we'll be part of a heavenly kingdom that's forever. And God's going to build a new heaven and a new earth, and they're not going to be taken away. They're an eternal one. So the idea here is you want to go back into kingdom theology. You want to try to build a kingdom for God. Remind yourself, understand, and know this, my friend. That's going to be destroyed. It's going to be smashed. It's going to be crushed. But the kingdom that we're part of is one that lasts forever. And the final reminder here is, for our God is a consuming fire. For our God is a consuming fire. And here we see a reference that is not to the saved only, but it is to the wicked. The fact of the matter is that these Jewish believers who are defaulting or going back on their faith, the major motivation for it is those who do not know God, right? In other words, the reason they're going back from serving God is from persecution, and from persecution by those who do not follow Jesus. And their motivation to not follow God is people. And here we're reminded in this final passage not to refuse God, Because God is a consuming fire. In other words, He'll consume the wicked. And if He's that kind of a God, then my friend, do you think you can escape? Do you think you can tell Him, God, I've chosen this way, I've decided this way? Let me conclude with a couple of comments. First of all, this is not some occultic, don't leave following Jesus or you'll be destroyed idea here. This is not God saying, you better follow me because you're afraid of me. But the idea here is that God's going to destroy the wicked, and if you go to be with the wicked, you'll be destroyed as well. And the warning here for the believer is that if you think that God cannot reach you, if you think that you can go back from following Jesus, or you can live in sin and God cannot reach you, remember that our God is a consuming fire. It's amazing how many believers think that God has some kind of a restraining order because Jesus died for us. In other words, God can't touch us. My friend, there is chastising for those. And I will remind you that when God used a human instrument to destroy Jerusalem in 70 AD, those Jewish believers in Jesus who had gone back were destroyed along with their unbelieving brethren. Because God is a consuming fire. And when God said, it's done, it's over, it's finished, God was finished with the temple. There's going to come a day in the millennial kingdom where Christ is going to build a temple. God's going to build a temple. They're not building it. The Temple Institute isn't building it in Jerusalem. They say, we've got all the instruments, we've got everything ready to go in place when the temple's built. I'm going to tell you something. It won't take God very long to build a temple, and He doesn't need unbelievers' help. I know a lot of Christians that are all into that, and they're supporting it and for it, and they make a big deal out of, you know, what's happening in Jerusalem with the rebuilding of the temple. Friend, God's got that all handled. He can take care of it. But that's a future event. The reminder for today is that our God is a consuming fire. And you can go back to whatever it is. And for many of us here, it would not be Judaism. For some of us, it would merely be paganism. It's not easy for any person to come to Christ and follow Jesus. I'm amazed at how many family members want Sunday to be a sacred day after their family member got saved. It's amazing how many individuals come to Christ and they have family that resent that they worship God on the Lord's Day, the first day of the week. And what a big deal it is. They never spent time with their family before, but now we're going to have a picnic and you better be there or you don't love us. You know, if you say you love God, you're supposed to love us. I've seen it I don't know how many times. Haven't you? Now, how many Christians are saved and they got a family member that says, you need to drink with us or you need to do this with us. If you don't love us. And the reminder is that the same God that will destroy the unbeliever is the same God that will destroy those who are with Him in unbelief. We're not talking about eternal consequence. We're not talking about eternal life here, my friend. We're talking about this life. And these are individuals who have sacrificed their eternal, the things that they have gained that have eternal implications in this life, for things that can be destroyed in this life. And the warning is, if the things of this life can be destroyed, and those are the things you're holding on to, you'll be destroyed along with it. Christian, I want to ask you a question. What are you holding on to? What would you go back to? It can be the oddest things sometimes that we hang on to instead of following Jesus. But it's the very same thing if in our heart we've separated ourselves and we've come up with an alternative to worshiping God as He's prescribed for us in His Word. Father, I pray that You would impress this truth upon our hearts, and Lord, that we would learn from it, and that we would be helped by it, we pray in Jesus' name. Before we have our invitation this morning, I want to ask that every person would keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed for just a moment. And the reason we would ask this would be because we want every person here to have privacy for just a moment. Now, my eyes are open, and the reason is because I'm going to ask you a question. And a couple of questions, and I'd like every person to be able to answer privately without anyone else looking on. First question I have to ask this morning. If you're here this morning, and much of the Scripture sounds strange or removed to you, and the reason for that would be because if you're honest about it, you know that you're aware of God, that you believe in God, but you don't know that you know God as your Heavenly Father in a personal way. In other words, when we talk about receiving Jesus or being born again or having eternal life, those are things that you aren't sure that you've settled in your life. If that's you and you're here this morning, you say, Pastor, don't call me out, don't embarrass me, but I want you to pray for me because I don't know that if I were to die, that God is my Father and heaven's my home. Would you pray for me? Would you just slip your hand up so that I could know that to pray for you? I don't know for sure that I'm born again, that heaven's my home. Would you just slip your hand up so I could pray for you? Okay, I want to ask you a second question. You're here this morning and you say, Pastor, as the Word of God is preached this morning, either specifically or in a very specific way, God spoke to me about the heart's attitude of one who would go back from following Jesus, either to something that they clung to before Jesus or to something instead of Jesus. And God's convicted me about it. He's shown me something specific. God's talked to me about it. I know what it is. And I'm going to do business with him about that this morning. Would you just slip your hand up just so that I could know to pray for you? Pastor, pray for me. God showed me something. I know what it is. And God's talked to me about something. Okay? Just slip your hand up, slip it right back down. All right? Anyone else? Okay? All right, so in just a moment, we're going to have an invitation. The invitation is a time when we invite you to respond to what God said. You need to be saved? I have Brother Taj standing in the back of the auditorium this morning. And the reason he's there is he's got a Bible. And he can show you how to know that you have eternal life. If you need help with something, you need someone to pray with you, he's there for that as well. Also, there are many believers here in the auditorium. You'd know them if they know Jesus. And you'd say, I'd like that person to pray with me. Feel free in the invitation service to move and ask someone to pray with you. But if God's spoken to you and it's between you and him, then you just need to do business with him. And while we sing a song of invitation this morning, I would recommend for you that you just remain in your seat and just pray. Do business with the Lord Jesus. All right, if you look up this way, take your blue hymn books. We're going to turn to page 242. We're singing a song of invitation, and as we sing, God's spoken to you. Then you just do business with him. Page 242. We're going to sing Jesus, I Come. And if you're physically able to do so, why don't you stand to your feet so it'd make it easier for those who want to do business with God to move around you. Jesus, I Come. If you're physically able to stand, will you please? And we're going to sing this song. And as you sing it, if it's not the prayer of your heart, do business with God so that it will be.